Good morning, church. If you can all please stand along with us. Let's praise the Lord. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place. You would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. You rule the nations with truth and justice. Shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Lord, let your name. The morning breaks in glory. At your name, creation sings your story. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. And Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. And Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. For there's no one like our God. We will praise you, we praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing. For there's no one like our God. We will praise you, we praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing, we will sing. For there's no one like our God. We will praise you, we praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing. The Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. And Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
For the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me once depart. No tongue can bid me once depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because his sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, and God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Beholding there the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I can. Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. One with Himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with His blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see, nothing but the blood Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen. You can all take a seat. Amen.
Michael's gone missing. Good morning, church. Just a few announcements. They're quite regular announcements. I think next Wednesday, I know last Wednesday we didn't have a Bible study, rather Book of Revelation, but I'm sure Michael is going to try and get back to it this Wednesday coming. So you can join us here in the staff room in the school, and that's a 7:30. And there is obviously a Bible study online, on WhatsApp, every Thursday. And we're hoping, Michael's hoping to finish out the book of Revelation. I think we're towards the end of Revelation 22. Would that be right? 21, 22? And so that is this week. If there's any other announcements, let us know later and we can announce them. I'm not sure of anything else. We are obviously in March and spring is arriving. So have faith. Things will improve in the weather. And Patrick's Day is only a couple of weeks away as well. We'll be looking at Patrick's Day when that comes about. And Nikki is in England. She's been in England since last Tuesday. In England, just if you don't know, her father died just a little bit over a week ago. And she's still waiting to see, as it were, you know, him and to see his remains and see him go. It does take a lot longer in England. In Ireland, you could be dead and buried within 4 days, but it seems that in the UK, it could take up to 3 weeks. So do pray for her. She's hoping to return this Friday. She has a flight provisionally booked, but it really is in the hands of God and in the hands of the authorities in England, of course. But we do believe God is sovereign over that. So she is there at the moment. And I do believe we're going to do the breaking of bread. Am I right? And I think Victor is coming up, is it? Yeah. Are you ready for that? We'll sort that, I think. I'll chase that down right away. And it's just a breaking of bread. We'll just look forward to what our brother brings to us in relation to that. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is no religion or people in the world who celebrate the death of your master like we do. And I want to sympathize with Nikki for her great loss. Yesterday, some Jehovah's Witnesses came to my house and they tried to preach to me. And they were trying to explain to me that they were going to be having the Holy Communion. Of all the things that they do wrong in the Jehovah's Witness sect, but there is one thing I know that they do very well. They do it correctly. When they do the breaking of bread, they do not take it. I think, in my opinion, they know the danger of abusing the Holy Communion. I like to talk about the danger because Paul warned in the Bible. He said, whoever eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself. We don't want to be drinking and eating judgment of God on ourselves. The Bible warns in Hebrew that it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. The Holy Communion is not intended as an altar call. That is for, you know, when we talk about altar call, we are talking about calling people to come out and accept Jesus. This is not the Holy Communion. The Holy Communion is intended to remind us of the sacrifice that the Master made for us. We are not worthy of it, but we thank God for His grace, for the great sacrifice that He made for us on the Mount of Calvary, and by that, we have been set aside to participate and partake in the Holy Communion. And by that sacrifice, we obtain grace upon grace upon grace. And this is exactly what the Holy Communion stands for. We are no longer under this covenant of the flesh, but we are now under the covenant in the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from all sins. Paul warned in Corinthians chapter 2 Corinthians 5 verse 1 He says, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. In other words, we know the terror of the Lord. He knows the terror of the Lord, and he warns us. He warns people. He persuades people. And like I said before, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And now we may ask ourselves, what then do we need to do in order to freely partake of the Lord's Holy Communion? And Jesus explained that in John chapter 5, verse 7, when he said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then we are free. We can ask of him anything, including the grace that he has freely given unto us. So we abiding in Christ, by that we are now free from condemnation. And what does abide actually mean? It means to accept or act in accordance with the principle of the Lord. Let's abide. We abide in him. And if we do that, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So at this point, I want us to meditate on ourselves and examine ourselves, talk to God. This is to remind us of the sacrifice that he made for us. So let's just take a moment of silence and meditate on ourselves and communicate with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us on the cross of Calvary. By that sacrifice, you have redeemed us from the curses of the law and the powers of darkness. And you have transformed us into your kingdom, and you have made us partaker of your promise. And as we renew and remember what you did for us, we will now come forward to take the bread and wine, and then we'll continue from there. Please feel free to come forward and take the bread and wine. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks. He broke the bread and distributed it among his disciples and said, take this, all of you, and eat. This is my body, which will be broken up for you. So we can now take the bread. And after that, he took the cup of wine and gave it to his disciples and said, drink, this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for all men so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. And as we eat and drink, we proclaim his death until he returns. The Lord be with us all. Amen. So at this point, we can return our bottles and our glasses and remember your offerings. Offerings, please. Father Lord, we thank you for these free will offerings and whatever it is that anyone has decided to give from his own heart. And we thank you, Lord, because we know that you have accepted our offerings. You have given to us and we are giving to you. We bank on you, O Lord, for increase in Jesus' name. Amen.
What else? There's an announcement I wanted to make, but I couldn't get it on time. But I did try to tell people in advance, tomorrow night, okay, it's a special night because there's a joining together of other churches if they want to come here tomorrow night in one of the classrooms. As you come in the door, at the car park door, and go straight up the corridor, there's going to be a classroom there for the Slavic Gospel Association. Now, you heard me talk about that before. And it would be nice to have a turnout of people. This is only once in a blue moon, and this Monday is a blue moon, okay? Not joking, it could be a rare occasion, okay? So what is Slavic Gospel Association? It is a group of people that go around Europe, but especially in planting churches and establishing new works, evangelizing parts of Europe way out to the east, okay? And they do a great work. And so they bring testimony and they bring their pastors with them. And good to see our Spanish-speaking friends from Bolivia. And if you're struggling with the English, we have one copy right there. Okay, so they did. Okay, cool. Well, let's just pray. Father God, I pray that you would help us to get into what we're looking at in the Word of God today, that you would bless us and give us understanding in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, lead us and guide us into all truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I wanted to make at least a start in Matthew chapter 23. And doing so, I also switched over to a different Bible. So it'll be the ESV. If you're checking for which Bible to look at, it should be ESV. Big, heavy Bible here. Okay? Some of you have got one similar. Okay? So we'll be looking at Matthew chapter 23, and hopefully I won't need glasses for this. And we'll read the section. It's actually verses 1 down to 12, and it says, Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat, so do and observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do, for they preach but do not practice. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long, and they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues, and greetings in the marketplaces, and being called rabbi by others. But you're not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all brothers. And call no man your father on earth, for you have one father who is in heaven. Neither be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Christ. The greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." We had to break the chapter down a little bit because there's so much in this chapter to come. And if you recall the whole point of it all, this is the week, as I've said many times, leading up to the crucifixion. So it's getting quite intense. And Jesus is basically throwing down the gauntlet to the religious leaders. And they're going to come into big conflict. And by the end of this week, Jesus will be crucified. So he's obviously going to be saying some provocative things. Yeah? And he's already dealt with some of their questions, and they've had a bit of a debate back and forth in the previous two chapters, you recall, chapters 21 to 22, and now we're into chapter 23. And he has basically dispatched the religious leaders. Now that they're all gone, who's left? Well, it seems like who's left are the crowds and Jesus' disciples. So the crowds, of course, when you come to a big festival, a big event like the Passover, Jerusalem would have swollen in size. Whatever the population was normally, it would have gone to, they say over a million, maybe millions of people coming to Jerusalem on that occasion. So it's a great opportunity for Jesus to get the message out there. But he does start off in this chapter by saying, then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, we know who we're talking to here. The Pharisees are gone. We don't have to worry about them anymore. Although you never know, there could be some who are mingling in amongst us or amongst the crowd somewhere. And they weren't all bad, were they, all these Pharisees? Did you know that the word Pharisee actually comes from the word separatist? So what were they doing? They thought, this is the idea of the Pharisee, we need to be separating ourselves from sinful people. We need to be, and this is an official quote from the Open Bible, that they had a burning desire, these separated ones had a burning desire to separate themselves from those people who did not observe the laws of tithing and ritual purity, matters that they considered to be extremely important. And maybe their goal was right. They thought, if we would just live right, we would be right with God. If we would just live exactly by the law, every detail of it, God would bless us. You understand? And then we would be that glorious Israel once again, if we could only get back to doing everything according to the letter of the law. That's the idea of the Pharisees. So you understand their goal, but their ways of accomplishing the goal, it would never have been accomplished, because you can never please God by the obedience to every letter of the law. Try as you may, okay? So that's what he said to his disciples. The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Now, what does that mean? Was there an actual seat in the synagogue called Moses' seat? It may have been. They say there's a possibility that there was a seat. The scribe and the Pharisee would come and say, that's my seat. Not that it has the name Moses written on it, Moses' seat, but that we sit in that seat in the synagogue, and they may have taught from that synagogue seat. Or it may have just been a way of saying, it's just for purposes to say, I have that place of authority. That's my responsibility to sit in that designated position of teacher. Okay, you understand? They had like what you would call a chairperson or a chairman, it used to be, or a chairwoman. Now it's a chairperson. The person who's chairing the meeting, that's basically what it's saying here. Now, what is he saying? He's saying they sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, he says, so do and observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do. For they preach, but do not practice. So what he's saying is, as much as they sit in that seat of authority, and as long as they open up the Word of God, and as long as they do their duty in teaching you the law of Moses, then do what they say. Do what is according to what is taught in the Scriptures. Their responsibility, okay, was to expound the meaning of the law. And as far as, if they're doing that, then you should do what they say. However, he adds, But do not do the works they do, for they preach but do not practice. Have you ever heard someone say, you need to practice what you preach? Well, that's what was wrong here. They were telling the people what they ought to be doing and how they should be doing things, but apparently they were not doing that themselves. They were just telling people the rules and the regulations, but weren't living that life themselves, okay? So here's a few examples of what kind of things that we're talking about. It says in the next part, in verse 4, they tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulders. But they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. So what does this mean? You work ahead, work away and take the bread and the wine. Yes, 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 go ahead. I know, no problem, you go ahead. Okay, so, right. Can you just imagine an animal? Do you know what a pack animal is? Like a llama, a donkey, or maybe a camel. And you would maybe see someone putting heavy goods on it. And just it goes on it, and there's a massive big... You've seen some of those photographs maybe on YouTube or on Facebook or whatever, with somebody just like an enormous weight put upon something, or even on a car. I remember the time I went to Nigeria, and Victor has me pushing this trolley, and this a mountain of stuff that I had to take over there, or we took over there. I just imagine a heavy burden, and maybe putting a burden upon a pack animal. Have you ever heard the saying, that's the straw that broke the camel's back? Or that was the last straw? I mean, if you're putting on haystacks, and it's like, okay, it's still, we can put a few more on there, but then you put on the last straw, next thing, it buckles beneath, okay? Well, then transfer that idea to people, that these religious leaders were adding more and more rules, regulations, details to these people's lives, to the point where we can't take it anymore. You're crushing us with all these rules and regulations. Okay, so that's what he says, that they just lay these on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. They wouldn't do a thing to help them. Now, what is Jesus like in comparison to that? Well, if you turned over to Matthew chapter 11, now, this is something he has said earlier, and we would have covered it. And he says this, listen to this, compared to the religious leaders of his day, Jesus says these words, Matthew 11, 28, it says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. See the difference right there? I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Is there a bit of a comparison there? He's not the guy who's going around saying, oh, I have such a burden I can hardly bear. His is easy. He finds it easy. Okay, and he's saying, I want you to experience it. I'll take off those burdens from you, not put them on you. Come to Jesus and he'll put more burdens on you, more rules and regulations. And you know, it just reminded me of certain cults and sects that are out there that are just filled with rules, that you come to church and you're getting beat up all the time. You're getting things, you're getting rules and more little instructions, and you can't do this and you can't do that. Always put on you, and you'll go away feeling like, oh my goodness, why did I even come to church? This is terrible. I feel worse when I came out than when I went in. Do you want that? Or do you want to say, thank God he lifted my burden? Yeah? He showed me the way to do things that are biblical, and it's actually, look what he says there, right there. You will find rest for your souls. That's what you want, right? For my yoke is easy, not hard, and my burden is light. That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Well, that's what he was saying, and then you can compare that with the Pharisees and scribes. Does that make sense when it says they lay them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger? Then it says they do all their deeds. This is verse 5. They do all their deeds to be seen by others. I don't know if we know anyone who would do that. I mean, come on. Who would be a show-off? You ever see show-offs? Want to be seen? Draw attention to the fact of what they're doing? Well, this is what these people were doing. They wanted everyone to know that they've done a good deed. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, draw attention to themselves. And to do that, just to highlight that, it says, for they make their phylacteries. Now, I don't know if you've heard that term before, but it is called the tefillin, and it is little leather boxes tied by straps to the foreheads or the arms or both of religious Jewish people. And in those days, they seemed to do this as well. So they had these little leather boxes in which they had scriptures. And so you tied that to your arm with bindings, or you had it around your head. Now, is there a biblical basis for this? Well, they would have said, well, doesn't the Bible tell us to do this? Well, actually, he does, and it's back in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 18. Okay, if you can look that up, Deuteronomy 11, 18. Okay, got that. It says, you shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul, and you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall teach them to your children, talking to them when you are sitting in your house, and when you are walking by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall write them on the doorposts. So there's all these things are little rules. But does it mean to be literally tie them on your head and literally tie them on your arm? Or was it an illustrative way of saying you need to be so into the Word of God that it's like a like it's on your mind and it's on your hand, it's on your life? These people, I don't know if it was to be taken literally or not. I really don't know. But these people thought that that was a legal requirement, that they had to do that. But they didn't just have a little box. No, no. The bigger the box, the better, you know, to draw attention to how spiritual you were. It would be like somebody walking into church, you know, with their three-piece suit on, looking the part, all polished up, but under their arm, they're carrying not just a little tiny Gideon Bible that they got from school. Well, no, they have the family Bible. You know, them big ones that people had in their houses in the olden days. Big family Bible, walking in there just to show how spiritual they were. Okay, that's what they would have done. Not only that, but we're told that they also, they made their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. Now, this has nothing to do with hairstyles. I know there's some people today with fringes that might cover their faces. It's not talking about fringes like that, just in case people might not, you know background of the Old Testament. It's talking about in Numbers, you can look this up, Numbers chapter 15, the people of Israel were told, Numbers 15, verses 38 to 39, that the people were to have tassels. Okay? Verses 38 to 39. It says, speak to the people of Israel and tell them to make tassels on the corners of their garments throughout their generations, and to put a cord of blue on the tassel of each corner. And it shall be a tassel for you to look at and remember all the commandments of the Lord, to do them, not to follow after your own heart and your own eyes, which you are inclined to whore after. So you shall remember and do all the commandments, and be holy to your God. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God. So basically, these are reminders of their, to remind them to obey the word of God. So they had little tassels or little threads. You might see this on Jewish people today, on their prayer shawls, okay? But what did these Pharisees do? The longer the tassels, the better. The more spiritual you were. And there were two schools of thought. There was Hillel and there was Shammai. And one had, I forget which one is which, but one had a longer thread or tassel than others, just to show how spiritual they are. So the whole point is, these people wanted to be seen by men in what they did. Okay? So, not only that, verse 6, this is Matthew 23, verse 6, and they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues. So basically they come in, they like to have... I never liked that, by the way, where you had chairs on the platform, special seats for special people, reserved. You ever go into a place and think, they're all reserved? What do you mean? Who are they reserved for? These are all the reserved seats, special seats, or someone's got a balcony seat or a special box, you know. He said, these people, they want all of that. So some people, did you know, didn't even get a seat at all. You could sit on the floor. Wow. Well, that's basically how it was. Okay, so they loved the place of honor and feasts and the best seats in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplace. and being called rabbi by others. So how many times does this guy go to the market? He goes as often as possible just so he might bump into somebody who said, oh, rabbi, and bowing down. Because rabbi, you know, I think you might know it means teacher, but it also means my lord or master. So for them to have people coming up to them continuously saying, my lord and master, they usually said that to teachers, or especially rabbinical teachers or teachers of the law. So that's what they love. I mean, imagine saying, oh, I must go into town again. I forgot something. I must go back to market because I forgot. Oh, good to see you, sister this, sister that. And they're all calling you whatever, rabbi. And greetings in the marketplace may be called rabbi by others. But he says in verse 8, but you do not be called rabbi, for you have one teacher and you are all brothers. You know, the whole point of that is to say, when it comes to brothers and sisters in Christ, we are all the same, are we not? We don't need special titles. We don't need to be called teacher. We don't even have to be called pastors, elders, or all of that. We know that people have a responsibility or a role. And yet in some cultures, it's very common for people to use titles. Isn't that right? But there are titles that are maybe a bit over the top, you know. But let me just say this. When it comes to when you have one teacher, on who is that? What do we read right there? But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher. We have one teacher, and that is Jesus Christ. But that will cause a bit of a problem, because there are places in the Bible where it does say that God has put in the church teachers. So what do you do with that? We'll come to that momentarily. But first of all, before we go there, he says, for you are all brothers. Martin Luther taught a doctrine called the priesthood of all believers. And that was based on 1 Peter chapter 2. I'm sure you're familiar with it. So it's not like he made this up. This is from the Bible, okay? So the priesthood of all believers. How many of you are a priest? Okay, so let's have a look at this. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 to 5, it says, as you come, I haven't got my glasses on, I hope I'm reading the right one. Yes, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by man, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And then verses 9 to 10, it says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So you are a royal priesthood. So when someone says, is there a priest around here? You should say, we all are. We all are priests. How are we all priests? Because we're all offering up sacrifices of praise and offering thanksgiving to God. That's what priests do in the New Testament. Okay? So the idea of being called... let's say someone has a title, Right Reverend. Ever heard some of these titles that people have for their minister? The Right Reverend, Dr. So-and-so, Bishop even. Well, Bishop, we're all elders are bishops, so to be giving them a special title like Bishop is just not necessary. And the whole idea is you are all brothers, okay? Let me move on. Going back to Matthew 23, verse 9, and call no man on earth your father. Am I getting it right? And call no man your father on earth. See, I'm so used to reading the New King James that I'm getting the words mixed up. Okay. And call no man your father on earth. Oh, dear. Does that mean that we're in trouble? Because I always called my dad. Well, I didn't call him father. I referred to him as my father. We always called our parents mommy and daddy, okay? Is that okay? So if I call someone on earth my father, is there a problem? Depends on the context, doesn't it? But if you were saying, oh, father so-and-so, I don't think we should be doing that. And there's some of you grew up in a religious, denomination, such as the Roman Catholic Church. Many of you would have been so used to calling some man your father, and you go, he's not my father. But spiritually, is he your father? Is he your father in some sense? Well, even that, this is what Jesus was saying. He's obviously not talking about calling some man your dad, your father. He's talking about when you call someone spiritually your father, you ought not to do that. And I wouldn't even do it out of respect, to be honest, because I don't respect the title, because the Bible says, don't call this person your father. Well, don't just look at the Roman Catholic Church. Did you know that in Pentecostal churches, there are many, you walk in, and the pastor is daddy. Yeah, is that right? Daddy. And the wife of the pastor, sometimes called pastora, okay, she's either the first lady, where on earth does this come from? Or she's mummy. Have you been in churches like that? Mummy and daddy. And that's the Pentecostal churches. They ought to know better, because the scripture tells us that you are not to call any man on earth your father, obviously in the spiritual sense, for you have one father who's in heaven. That's if you are a believer. Amen? Neither be called instructors, verse 10, neither be called instructors. Now, I think the New King James or the King James Version would have said, don't call anyone teacher. So I think making a little bit of a difference here, neither be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Christ. Now, this is important because God has set in the church teachers or instructors, okay? For example, you could turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And remember, these are not set themselves in the church, but it was the different giftings that God put in the church. Okay? So, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 27, now you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it, and God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? I think the answer expected there is nope. Are all prophets? Again, we're expected to say nope. Are all teachers? Nope. Do all work miracles? Nope. Do all possess gifts of healing? No. Do all speak with tongues? Nope. I'm just saying that's the expected answer, okay? Do all interpret? No. But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I'll show you a still more excellent way. So here we go. God is the one who set teachers in the church to teach people the Word of God. And that's not the only place. One other one is very important is Ephesians chapter 4. And speaking about the same kinds of things, it says that when Jesus ascended on high, let's look at this. And going back to what Jesus said about you have one Father in heaven, we can start with verse 4. So Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4, there is one body. True believers are the one body of Christ. And one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, that is for the believer, of course, who is over all and through all and in all, but grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. So basically, as he went up, he showered blessings down. He sent down gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean? But that he also descended into the lower regions, the earth. He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Tells you a lot about the deity of Christ right there. He fills all things. Verse 11, and he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers. What's the purpose of that? To equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine. That's what happens, isn't it? When you're not established, you get tossed over the place by all the different things you hear. Oh, I was listening to this thing on the internet and it's confused me now because I don't know what to believe anymore. And you can get tossed to and fro, but you need to be established. And this is the purpose of teaching and the other gifts, not just the teacher, but all the different giftings, to equip the saints. So you're no longer tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. So there's a purpose in God putting different ones in the church. But didn't Jesus say, you don't need anyone, you only have one teacher? What about what John says in 1 John? This has come up in, I think, one of our Bible studies not too long ago. Okay. 1 John chapter 2, verses 26, it says, I write these things to you. I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you. Did you know that there are people who might be trying to deceive you? Okay. But the anointing that you have received from him abides in you. How many of you have got an anointing? Two people. I thought all believers had an anointing. It's not some special person who comes in, oh, here comes the anointed one. Every believer has the anointing within them. The anointing that you received from him abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you, but as his anointing teaches you about everything and is true and is no lie, just as it has taught you, abide in him. If you weren't on that basis alone, you'd say, well, why do I need anyone to teach me? I don't go to church. I don't need anything. I just get taught by the Holy Spirit because we don't need anything else. But you've got to balance that up with other texts in the Bible, which says he put some in the church to be teachers. So, and what was John, who wrote that, doing when he wrote that? Teaching. Very point of what he was doing. Okay. And then, of course, could be, yeah. And you know what? There's that anointing that is within you. I think what you'll find is that it will bear witness to the truth. And you'll be going, I may not know my Bible, but I do know something's wrong here. Ever experienced that? Something's not right here. And you can't put your finger on it, but you might go, but I just know that something's not right. Okay? And the Holy Spirit will lead you. If you're a true child of God, I do believe he will lead you in line with the scriptures. Okay? Now, there's another scripture. This just is one more about teaching, and that's in James chapter 3. Just to say that there definitely are people who are, that's their responsibility. James chapter 1 says this, not many of you should become teachers, my brethren, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. So, yep, just like Riley was saying there, you know, those people who are teaching, they're going to have to, they have a higher standard. No wonder that Jesus said, these Pharisees, now, I don't think that Jesus had any time for the Sadducees. I'm not messing with those clowns. But the Pharisees, they have the responsibility, they sit in Moses' seat, they have the responsibility to teach, and they ought to be teaching correctly, okay? So that's why he says in James here that not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. So there's going to be a time when everything that we've ever done is going to be held up to God. Say, well, What were you doing? And there's going to be loss of rewards, it would seem. Okay, so just to bring this down to back to Matthew chapter 23, you can see what the point of it all of it is. Those guys, they have a responsibility. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. They're giving, instead of helping you, and I'm going to give you a quotation if I can find it, okay? They multiplied the number of ways in which a man can offend God. That's what they could say. They were using the Bible and said, oh, I can find something to point out where you're going wrong. I can give you more rules and regulations. They can tell you that all the different ways that you can offend God. I can find verses to find something to point out where you're being offensive to God. They were good at that. But what they weren't good at was showing you a way which would actually please God, which is the way of faith. Okay, we heard it last time from Eddie, did we not? Last week, about faith. The only thing that's going to please God is what? Faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if you're saying, well, I thought I was pleasing God by doing everything so meticulously, and that's the problem with religious people who think, I thought that my goodness, my efforts, my obeying the law meticulously would put me in right standing with God. And all it did was made you more and more feeling condemned, okay? When you could have come to Jesus and learned from him and learned a way of faith which takes off those burdens and gives you something by which you can approach God. So listen to this, and we'll close with this. Jesus said, you have one instructor, the Christ. Verse 11, the greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Let me ask you this. Who would have been the greatest among them at that time? Jesus himself. But he's saying, amongst you, if you really want to be great, and there are people like those guys, maybe even today, they want people to honor them, salute them, give them special titles. They want to be served. They want to have everything done for them. And I've been in cultures where that is, oh, you have to do everything for the pastor. He's your pastor. You should be doing everything for him. And that's fine. And we should serve one another, but there's not to be special, I want that, needing that. I need that, demanding that. And that's what the problem was. And if there's anyone who deserved it, it would have been Jesus Christ. But he's talking about amongst you, he said. He said, whoever exalts himself, if you want to know, first of all, if the greatest among you has to be what? Your servant. Okay, what is the primary place of the ministers of God in the church is to serve. Isn't that right? Servants. So the greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted. And who better to learn from on that particular way of doing things than Jesus Christ himself? Did you know in John chapter 13, you don't have to look at it, but you would know that that's the night coming up not long after this, by the way, where he would wash his disciples' feet. I think it's one of the most powerful illustrations in the Bible of humility. The God of all creation is in the flesh, and he's not saying, wash my feet, serve me, I'll be waiting at the table, hand out waiting for something to be given to him. What was he doing? He took off his outer robe, put on a towel, and he went round all the 12 disciples and he washed their feet. How many feet did he wash? That's a good question to ask. How many feet did he wash? Say 24. Okay. That's by counting 12 disciples times 2. Very good. Unless one of them has gone, I don't know who was actually there, but supposing he washed all 24 feet. And he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, is bowing down in front of these people and washing their feet. Would you have wanted him to wash your feet? Are you to say, come on, this is not right. You shouldn't be doing that. But he does that himself, doesn't he? He humbles himself. And this is living out what we read in the last verse we're going to look at, Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes about Jesus and says, he's your example. Verse 5, Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, it says, where is it? Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped or held on to, not letting go, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by coming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So he went not only as a servant, but he went all the way to saying, I'm the servant of the Lord. I'll do what Jehovah, God Almighty, is asking of me, and I will live as his servant and serve him all the days of my life. Humbling himself even further, even to the point of death on a cross. Verse 9 says, therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We have him as our example. And so he's the one who's coming to people who have been broken down by religion. And instead of saying, I've come to give you a whole new bunch of rules to live by, he's saying, learn from me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I don't want you to be beat up and crushed by these heavy, oppressive rules. I want to give you freedom, and you can come to Jesus for that. Okay, he's saying all this, and he's really making a comparison between those Pharisees and scribes and the way of Jesus Christ. And soon he will go all the way to the cross, just like he said. Okay? So the question is, have you ever been crushed under those kinds of rules and regulations? Ever felt beat up and heavy burdened? Have you ever thought, like, I don't want to be miserable in my Christian life? And there are some miserable Christians because they're just living by rules. Okay? We need to get to them to the place where they can see that there's another way, Christ Jesus. Hello? Hello. So we've just come to the end of our service, and I hope I covered all the points. But one last thing, I suppose, there is one verse I didn't mention. Jesus was pointing out that those religious leaders, the scribes and Pharisees, okay, they give the people the instructions, but they themselves did not live by those instructions. They didn't practice what they preach. And the brother of Jesus, or half-brother of Jesus, said this in James chapter 1. Okay, I will just turn to this and we'll close with this. James chapter 1, and it's verses 22 to 25, and we read this. You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture, am I in the right place? No, I'm not in the right place. James chapter 1, verses 22, I was in chapter 2 there. Okay, but be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, that's what we have in Jesus Christ, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. So what is he saying? Don't just look into the law of the Word of God and just say, oh, I forgot what I just read. Go and do what it says, and you will be blessed, and you will be you will have liberty in Jesus Christ. Amen? Let's close there. And I want to offer you the opportunity. If you have said, that's all I've ever known, all my life, whether it's in religion or as a Christian, all I've known is rules, regulations, I have no joy. I would say, come to Jesus today and say, Lord, it's time I laid down all those things and took up your way and learned from you. Help me, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for those who are here today, every one of us, even those who are listening, that you would let them experience your freedom, that your liberty that is in Jesus Christ. Amen? Let the power of God's Spirit and His Word go to work in your life this day in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so are we doing a closing prayer? Or song, I mean? Or are the children coming in?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down. Sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The grave, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen, amen, amen. Have a blessed week. Amen.
Amen. Yes. Stay for fellowship. We have tea and coffee.